On today's show,
LeBron wants to form an NBA super team with his brotherhood, but just how realistic is his dream?
It's Throwback Thursday. We discuss the late, great Drazen Petrovic. Which legend called him the best shooter ever?
And shake it out, big guy. We've got a brand new edition of the meme team for you.
It's Thursday, March 24th. The starter starts now.
Good evening, Sweet World, and welcome to The Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us on NBA TV and or YouTube, we're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Millis.
Tim Duncan, number of days left in the NBA season.
Excellent. To his right, it's the international man of mystery taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend.
Lele.
Lele, last, certainly not least, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Hey-o!
Hey-o!
Trey, what do you got for us tonight, buddy?
Well, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at hashtag the starters, and it's been a couple of months since we made fun of your fan art, so I thought let's fire up another round of the starters art critics.
Okay.
Our first submission comes to us from Josh Rollins. That's a beauty.
That's good.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, really nailed my squinty eyes that you can't even tell if they're ever open. Got Lee's hairy arms, too. This is perfect. Tass is tucked in jersey. I love it.
Garbo.
Yeah, that might be a car, but we gotta see the back. Gotta see the back of this drawing. Our next submission comes to us from Sneak Freak, and it's also really great. One quibble, where's Tass's beard?
Yeah.
Mm. Looks like he's got a completely blank face. I've never seen Tass unshaved. Nonetheless, pretty good.
Lee's Dilbert glasses. Yeah,
real tiny Dilberts on there. But our final masterpiece comes from Aaron, who recreated the infamous no-hug scene between Skeets and Tass. And major shout out to working in one of Lee's short sleeve dress shirts, which he has on today. Please keep these fan arts coming. Tag them, hashtag the starters. We'll make fun of them some other time.
Yeah, I was gonna say, there's the hair, there's the.
Ready for that barbecue, baby.
Oh yeah.
But make these drawings crappy. Can't make fun
those
of these.
Good.
These are actually too
yeah,
good.
Yeah, these are good ones.
But keep them.
Sorry.
That's okay. All right, on tonight's show, it's Thursday, which means it's an NBA Throwback Thursday edition here on The Starters with one of the greatest shooters of all time, Drazen Petrovic. So that's going to be a lot of fun. But we also have the meme team. We got a lot on Thursdays. Let's start with the fill-in-the-blank segment of the show, though. This is a lot of fun, guys. We start with LeBron. As the King's World turns, the latest episode is in Howard Beck's new Bleacher Report article, LeBron James admitted he would love to play on an NBA team alongside his buddies, Carmelo Anthony, Chris Paul, and Dwayne Wade before his career is over. Quote, I really hope that we can all play together at least one or two seasons. I would actually take a pay cut to do that. So we ask you to play along on Twitter, hashtag the starters to fill in the blank. LeBron wanting to join up with Melo, Chris Paul, Wade is as realistic as blank.
I think it's as realistic as the sun coming up. I think he can make it happen if he wants. He is a very powerful man. He likes to flex those muscles. He's a power broker. He can make it happen if he wants. We've seen three guys in their prime get together. Why not four in their later years? What would prevent them from getting together? Money? I don't think that would be an issue. I think these guys have managed it extremely well. I think, yes, logistically, would they be free agents all at the same time? I think that's a legitimate concern.
Yeah.
But these guys are all signing one-year deals just so they can go wherever they want. If they want to make it happen, I think they can make it happen. That's how powerful these guys are.
I would like to see it happen, actually, just to see how the product would look on the floor, because it's great to say we all want to play together, but remember, there is only one basketball, and Carmelo, we know, likes to get shots, LeBron likes his shots, and Chris Paul likes to have the ball in his hand as well. But I think considering the stage of their career it would be at, I think it would probably be unlikely they would have the success they might hope. Because if you remember, Charles Barkley, Scottie Pippen, and Hakeem Olajuwon got together on those Rockets teams, or the Rockets team in the 98-99 season. They made the playoffs, but they got beaten by the Lakers. They just didn't quite make it happen because they were at the wrong stage of their career. They were at the end. And, I mean, these guys are all in their 30s now, and LeBron's been to the championships now, like five, he's been there the last 5 years. At some point, I think it's going to catch up with you as well.
I like LeBron, or I know LeBron, likes showing that he is a powerful man. And he likes showing it year after year. That's why he signs these one-year deals. I think he would enjoy the fact that he would put this team together. And that's what he did in 2010, you know, to a lesser extent, by one guy. And yes, you're right. I mean, who knows about the success? But I think that if he wanted to do it, he could do it.
Where is the team
hypothetically
put together,
though? That's a good question.
And it is going to be years. I mean, we got James and Wade as possibly free agents this year, but Chris Paul not till 2017, termination option. Melo the year after that as a possibility with the termination option. So it's going to be a while if this even ever comes to fruition. I think this is just a guy who, we should point out, Howard Beck, that's our article up on Bleacher Report, is great. It's really about Melo and LeBron's relationship. Yeah. This was asked to LeBron around the All-Star break. And I think he's in a good mood. He is around his buddies. You know, we saw the photos with them. You know, we've seen the photos before where they're drinking wine and they're on the banana boat having a time. Yeah. I think he's just, you know, he's around his friends. He's like, wow, that would be great.
Yeah,
that'd be fun. I don't think there's really that much to it.
No, you can't blame a guy for wanting to play with his buddies, you know, especially these all-star buddies. And remember, they did play on the Olympics together. So they have had success on the Olympic stage. This is obviously different going through an 82-game season, but...
Yeah, here's the photos. Yeah. Cheers in here. Look, you said you can't blame a guy for wanting to get together with his buddies.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people would disagree with that statement here in an NBA context. What? I think a lot of people look at this idea even, of this idea, just like they did when the Big Three got together in Miami with Bosch in the mix, and they go, this is ridiculous. Why?
But I don't think they care about that. Why would LeBron care?
No, they obviously don't.
I mean, he wants to play. He wants to play with his friends. I don't think you can hold a grudge against the guy for that.
Yeah, the quote is in that Howard Beck article where LeBron said to Melo, I mean, it'd be great to play together. And I think there is something to this because we saw it in 2010. Those guys are friends.
Yeah.
Well, him, Wade, well, that's two parts of it that already got together. You know, throw in a CP, throw in a Melo.
The problem would, though, come back to, you know, they said prepared to give up salary, which is fine, but how much would you be prepared to give up so you can still surround the rest of the team with quality role players?
No, they can play 4-on-5.
Well, these guys are business.
Sacramento, then they can play the 4-on-5.
Yeah. Well, they're business moguls. They have money in the bank, so I think they'd be comfortable. It would be later. It wouldn't be now.
Trey, you got something for us?
Yeah, I got a great tweet from Nishant who says LeBron wanting to join up with Melo, CP3, and Wade is as realistic as Task and Pizza Hug. Are you guys ready to make it happen or what?
No, only when they join up.
And the words of Jalen Rose likes to use, not going to be able to do it.
That's exactly right. I just think this is, he's asked at All-Star break, and he's just like, yeah, that'd be fun. And it will never, ever happen. I don't think it's very realistic at all. All right, moving on here. Warriors coach Steve Kerr, he says his players have earned the right to decide whether or not they'll be rested as the team continues to hunt the NBA record for wins in a season. Quote, it's the players who are setting a record. It's not the organization. If the players want to go and they're fine physically, we'll probably play them. Obviously picked up another win last night. They're not far off now of at least tying the Bulls and getting possibly 73. But fill in the blank. Kerr letting his players decide whether to rest or go for this record is what?
It's pretty empowering, right? The players can decide, hey, I want to play, I want to go for it, because he trusts them that much. This isn't a team like the Orlando Magic or another team where you can't trust the players. I think that would be an entirely different scenario. This is obviously a championship team. And if they're really injured, then they're going to sit down. But they're going for a record. And this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. Steve Kerr knows it. He was a part of it. And if they can make it happen, then it'll make it happen. If this was next year and they had already achieved that record, then they would be sitting down. You know, they wouldn't go for it. If the record books already said Golden State Warriors, 73-9, 15-16. Mm. So it's a different scenario. But I think the guys have to feel great about it. They are going to go for it. Their coach says, hey, you guys are good enough. Make the decision. I think they're going to love doing it these next 12 games. I think they're going to get it.
I think it must be great to work for Steve Kerr because he's not a dictator as a coach. He's someone who uses everybody within the organization, his assistant coaches and the players, to help make decisions. He's more a manager rather than a coach. He draws up the X's and O's and makes the substitutions. But allowing everyone to do that, like you say, Tass, it is empowering because you feel you have a voice, and I think that creates a great environment to play in. And I just think this is probably the new way of coaching. I think it's a progressive way of doing it by Steve Kerr saying, OK, I don't have all the answers. What do you guys think? Let's get together, talk it out. If you're healthy, play. If you're not, maybe you should sit out.
And we know Steph Curry has said, you know, this is something they're shooting for. Draymond Green has come out and quite frankly said, yeah, we're going for 73. We want 73. We want that record, our name in the record books. It also helps, and Steve Kerr brought this up, they're fortunate in a way that the San Antonio Spurs are still on their heels. Now, I know the gap's getting bigger and bigger here, but they are still, in theory, they haven't locked up the Warriors, haven't locked up the number one seed.
Right.
So it sort of goes hand in hand that they're still trying to win games, get that number one seed locked up, while, maybe set that record. So it's like almost the perfect storm, because I think if they had the number one seed locked up, you know, 10 games ago, I then think this is a little bit different. I really do.
But they are such a feel and flow team. They want to be feeling good going into the postseason, right? Because it's just a flow basketball team. They can just turn it on, but it is about them having the chemistry.
And unless they're playing the Spurs or the Thunder, I mean, a lot of these teams, they're sort of just playing against themselves.
Yeah.
So now, at least with the record in sight, they're almost playing for that record. It probably helps them in some of those games against lesser talent, I would think. All right, our final one here. Last night on Survivor,
heard
me. Former NBA center Scott Pollard got a little bit lucky when the reward challenge just so happened to be a basketball design game, or a little bit like netball there, Lee.
Yeah.
After falling behind 8-6 to some dude named Nick, Pollard got hot, nailed his last four shots, and won his team the picnic reward. Hashtag winning. Trey, I ask you, because you're the big Survivor fan here, Scott Pollard's basketball challenge on Survivor was more unfair than what?
More unfair than when Jennifer Grey was on Dancing with the Stars. Of course she was going to win. She was on Dirty Dancing.
Oh.
But there was a 23-year gap between that. Scott Pollard played basketball 8 years ago. He's still got it. You don't know him as an offensive player, but he shot 70% in an 11-year career from the free throw line.
Yeah.
That means he's probably a 90% shooter when he's just shooting around.
Yeah.
And as he told CBS's Zach Harper, he didn't feel any pressure because he's used to shooting in front of 20,000 people, not 20 and a couple of cameras.
You're right.
It was on fire. There was a little pressure from Nick, who did mention that he was a point guard for his high school team. He's tall. He's Jack. Nonetheless, Scott Pollard holding it down, hashtag winning.
All right, coming up next, we're back in again with NBA Throwback Thursday, talking about one of the greatest shooters of all time. Welcome back to The Starters. Today's NBA Throwback Thursday, hashtag TBT, is for the late, great Drazen Petrovic. The Croatian native was an early international star. He led the former Yugoslavians to gold medals at the European and World Championships, as well as a silver medal at the 88 Olympics, before developing into one of the NBA's top shooting guards with the Blazers, and really flourished when he went to the Nets there in his final two seasons. Sadly, Drazen's career and life were cut short after he died in a car accident at the age of just 28. He was in Germany when that happened. But really, only four seasons played, solid numbers at the shooting guard position, 15 points per game, couple assists, couple boards, just very high percentages. Went into the Hall of Fame in 2002. And again, a three-time Olympic medalist and a one-time All-NBA, made a third team there on his best year with the Nets. What do you remember of Drazen?
One of the first non-Americans to become a legit star.
Yeah.
Even when he came over, he still had to prove himself. He still had to push for that chance, and he didn't really get it in Portland. It wasn't until he went to New Jersey.
Well, he had Drexler and Porter, yeah. And then they got Danny Ainge, and he just buried.
He had a great team, and Rick Adelman did use him at times, but he never really gave him that green light and said, okay, you're going to be our guy. Got to New Jersey and really showed what he was made of out there. I mean, he was a fantastic player. The shooting is the first thing you think about with Drazen. You know, that release, that really he could get red hot and could carry that team. And he was someone who always believed in himself, and even when he was sitting on the bench for a long time, he never sort of gave up. He just maintained his fitness and was ready, and when he got his chance, like I said, he took it.
He had a bit of flair to him, too. He played with that passion,
emotion,
that energy.
Yeah.
I think sometimes, maybe back in the day, he was a trailblazer, I think, for a lot of guys. Like Dino Raja coming over, Tony Kukoc comes to mind, even Sabonis comes over after him,
yeah.
I mean, obviously much older. But he played in a weird way. It was almost like he had that sort of flair of an American to some extent. That's why I think he was such a big star when he starts putting up 20, 21, 22 points per game.
Yeah, they loved him in New Jersey for that reason.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, one of my memories was, you mentioned, the World Championships team where they won, the Yugoslavians won,
right.
Along with Vlade Divac, and there was the flag incident. And
yeah.
There was a lot of flair in that tournament. And you know, then, obviously, the Olympics happened, and the Dream Team happened right after that.
Right.
He was just a special guy. He was a special player. I love the 30 for 30, obviously, that ESPN did.
Oh, 30 for 30, Once Brothers, is amazing. This book, Lee, you picked this up.
Yeah.
Someone sent you this, and I've had a chance to read it, too. This book is money. Highly recommend. If you're looking for always basketball books, I don't know where you want that. There you go. Great book, draws in there. That is, it's amazing. It's about everything in his life from when he was a child, of course, into, unfortunately, sadly, his death at 28.
The entire world loved him, and his peers actually had a ton of respect for him. Here is 2011 edition of Open Court.
I consider myself the best shooter ever, but there's one guy that tops me.
Vinny?
And he got underneath my skin. And the reason why he got underneath my skin, because a lot of times I couldn't understand what he was saying. And it was the late, great Drazen Petrovic. Drazen Petrovic was my nemesis. I could not stand this guy, but to this day, I respect him because I think he is the best shooter I've ever seen in my life.
Serious praise from Reggie Miller. And you mentioned good percentages. Those are really good percentages for a shooting guard. At that time, to be well over 40% at the three-point spot and 50 from the field for a shooting guard, that's pretty phenomenal.
All right, it's always something we do here in TBT. It's not always easy, but who do you think is the modern-day version of Drazen Petrovic?
I think the automatic choice is Klay Thompson.
Okay.
The quick release, the ability to get really hot, that gorgeous stroke. I think Klay probably is what Drazen would have been if he'd played in this era today. You know, just a guy who was just such a good shooter and just so smooth. Drazen once scored 112 points in a game. Klay Thompson scored 37 and a quarter, so yes. There's another sort of resemblance there. But I think Klay was probably the first choice a lot of people associate with.
Yeah, that's a good pick. I think Chris Middleton a little bit. I mean, when you look at their stats, Chris Middleton, you know, into what, his fourth or fifth year here, and then you compare it to Drazen in his 4 years, they're really, really similar. And I think he's got that sort of takeover ability at times, that clutch gene, I guess. We saw Drazen hit some big shots for the Nets. We've seen Middleton early in his career for the Bucks do the same. Nice, smooth stroke, pretty compact. So he comes to mind, too. What about you, Trey? Anyone?
Maybe not so much old Manu Ginobili now, but younger Manu Ginobili, I think, is very Drazen Petrovic. The way he can play off the ball, but also super creative with the ball. Not an incredible athlete, but just crazy crafty to be able to get to the rim without being able to, you know, get over guys. I mean, they both could throw it down, but that's not their game. Little mid-range, little three-point shot, just able to do everything in the flair, obviously, with Manu's there as well.
All right, there's a couple names. Klay, Middleton, young Ginobili. Let us know who we've missed. Hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Who do you think's the modern-day version of the late, great Drazen Petrovic? Trey will have his eye on the Twitter accounts. All right, got to take a break. When we come back, lots more still to come. We'll do a brand new edition of the Meat Team. I don't want you to get distracted, though, okay? That's creepy.
Ooh.
Yeah.
112 points. What league was that in, Lee?
Croatia.
Welcome back to the starters. We asked you before the break, who do you think is the modern-day version of Drazen Petrovic? Hit us up on Twitter, hashtag the starters. Trey, you got a few answers.
Yeah, this seems to be a tough one. Ron Potatoes says, I would say Darren Williams of the Dallas Mavericks. I mean, he's a big guard. I don't know, it's a stretch.
Yeah.
Ben Chu says, it's Bojan Bogdanovic. Pretty emphatically, he says so. Okay. But I think the best answer comes from a bear, who says, based on skill and mentality, Dame Lillard's the closest one, and that's actually not bad.
That's actually a pretty good one, yeah.
I like it. Yeah. Keep them coming, guys. All right, every Thursday we scour the internet to bring you the Meme Team. It's our favorite weird and wacky moments from the past 7 days in the NBA social world.
At number five, the Rockets are known to put together some crazy free throw distractions, but they outdid themselves with this one. Because the green man jumps out of the recycling bin just before the free throw shot. I love how they have to put a hat on him.
Yeah.
The green man painted, not enough. Let's put this little hat on him. And it didn't work. No.
No.
Analytics, not good on that one.
Nuggets power forward Kenneth Faried missed Saturday's game to the Hornets because of nagging back issues, though that's not what the box score would have led you to believe. No, thanks to a comically painful typo, Faried there listed as DNP, low sack soreness.
At number three, Tuesday in OKC, this fan on the sideline, he was ready for this moment, the corral, and goes behind the back.
Yeah.
Whoa. The flair on this man.
I like the dribble, too. He puts it on the floor.
Yeah, Randy Foy's reaction. What are you doing?
It's a delay of game. Kyle Lowry and DeMar DeRozan's bromance continues in this commercial.
I made it. What do you mean?
I ain't move your rack.
My bad. I didn't move the rack. I just kind of
felt it move.
Why your arm higher on that side?
Mine.
No, it's mine.
That's the workout.
Bucket, wrap the claws and all. Sunroof.
Oh dog. My God.
Your touch is horrible.
There you go. Get in there. That wasn't that bad. I'm selling it.
3, 2, 1. Bucket.
Damn.
Yep. You only got one basketball. Don't touch my basketball.
Damn.
No, hey man, don't come on. Dunk it out of here.
Come on, I ain't got nothing.
Get out of here.
I ain't got nothing.
You ain't got no chance to come back. Winner.
You better go play the lottery tonight.
And at number one, odd situation Saturday. Dwight Howard sprayed a substance on his hands, grabbed the ball. Paul Millsap got it. He's like, what is going on? That ball is sticky.
That thing's gross.
They had to replace that ball. Dwight Howard and the evidence was confiscated really quickly. Dwight had a bad week. 3 days later, after losing this pass, it was a bad pass.
Yeah, bad pass.
CJ McCollum tweeted, he needed that stick-em, hashtag too soon. That was mean. A day later, Dwight Howard showed the ref, nothing on these hands.
Hey,
we're all good.
I'm
and
clean.
To top it all off, the kicker produced this completely fake video with the tweet, how did we not notice Dwight using stick'em years ago? That is so well edited. It fooled a lot of people.
I think so.
Right that's away. Good. Including us, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Well done.
Great. There it is, the Meme Team. Favorite weird, wacky moments from the past 7 days. Got to take one more break. But when we come back, Lili's very solid play of the night. But don't go anywhere. You want to learn some fundamentals. Back Pick'em Starters, tonight's Pick'em Play game. It's the Bulls and the Knicks going back-to-back here. Knicks surprising everyone with the win last night, but we all say the Bulls bounce back tonight, all four of us taking them in the Pick'em Play. Lee, where are we going for your very solid thumbs?
We all know about the Boston Tea Party. Well, how about the Boston Pump Fake Party? Jason Thompson was invited, and Terrence Ross, he turned up as well. He didn't want to go alone, old Jason Thompson. Jonas Jerebko finishes, and that's what I call a very solid play.
Nice one.
Beautifully, but not every pump fake party can be as well attended. That's why we have tonight's very unsolid play. J.R. Smith tries the 4-0 pump fake party. Nobody wants to come. But LeBron saves it with a touch pass.
Wow.
Gorgeous. Timofey Mozgov for the dunk. That's why you got to always invite LeBron to your parties, because he'll always help out. And that's what I call a very unsolid play.
We just keep hitting you with these clips. It's time for the highlight that wasn't. Wow. We're staying with LeBron. Even if a great play isn't converted, we're going to show it to you. LeBron, mad at all those people talking about him on social media. He's going to take it out on the rim. Oh, just missed. Look how far he takes off from. Way out.
Oh,
and he just missed. That would have been a huge highlight. Unfortunately,
Plumlee's
didn't
bad
make
he
it.
Missed.
Well, I feel left out. I feel left out here, guys. So it's time for my new segment called Come On Man, where I say, come on, man, to you, Tass, for passing on Reggie Jackson for your highlight that wasn't bouncing it in from the three-point line. Come on, man.
That's a trick shot.
Come on. That's a highlight that wasn't.
Yes, we do. Harry sent this one in from the Celtics game. Well done. Thank you very much. That's great. Harry Jess and his bud sent this sign in, but that's not the best part. Look at how they actually got this sign into the United Center. They smuggled it in. What a great job.
A very solid sign carry.
Yeah, wow.
And Max was in Germany at the Harlem Globetrotters game. He took a sign, got a selfie with one of the Globetrotters. Great job.
I believe that's cheese.
That's cheese.
Cheese.
No. Now, Kelsey Dallas and partner bought themselves very solid shirts for each other.
Wow. Beautiful.
Yeah, that's the couple that really thinks alike and they know each other really well. So I've got an extra one.
Did they know that they were ordering them, or did they just happen to come in the mail at the same time? How did that work?
Well, we'll have to ask them on Twitter. Find out.
Tomorrow morning, guys, the Drop Podcast. We get it up as early as possible. Get it up on the website and iTunes. We'll tweet it out, Facebook. It'll be everywhere. So catch that before we come back tomorrow night at 6 p.m. Eastern here on NBA TV.
All right, thanks for joining us, folks. We'll see you then. And remember, a lot of people still watch Survivor.
Race night, people.